1, 2, 3. We're recording. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of These Crazy Guys Are Just Talking About Eating Meat and Not Doing Much Else. Today, I have a special guest, Mark Wimmer, longtime carnivore, came to tell us their story, and one of my usual sidekicks, Raymond Sixpack Nazon. So today, we're going to learn a little something about what happens in the long run. So why don't you take it away, Mark, and tell us a little something about your journey on the carnivore train.
Well, in 2008, I'm 6 foot. In 2008, I'd gone up to about 280 pounds. And this is, I never was super obese, like 400 or 350. I was gaining weight quickly. And that was working out, strength training, aerobic training, eating what I thought was supposed to be a good diet, and the weight just kept coming on and on and on. Went to the doctor, got my metformin, I was diagnosed, and then I had high blood pressure, got my Benicart, which at the time is what the medication they gave me. Now I figured there got to be a better way. I figured it's time to lose the weight. So basically I kind of went on a bodybuilding starvation diet of chicken breast, tuna, salad, things like that. And in 3 months, I came down to 190 pounds. The only thing was, I couldn't sleep at night. I was starving all the time. And I couldn't go back to the way I was eating because I just bulked right back up again. So there got to be a better way. So I got into it, and I found people like Michael Leeds, Art Devaney, Lauren Cordain, Rob Wolf. These were all older people, Mark Sissons, and yeah, of course, Gary Taubes, Good Calories, Bad Calories. Mm-hmm. And I did actually order his book and read it from cover to cover.
That's a long book. Good Calories, Bad Calories.
It is a long book. It is full of information. And I did. I read it from cover to cover. Uh-huh. And so by the time I got done with this book, I wasn't too nervous about, I didn't like vegetables. You know, they gave me GI issues. So I basically went to meat, cheese, eggs. And that's been the standby since July of 2008.
How old were you, Ben, when you started?
I was about 41, I
think. Okay.
About 53 now. So I don't know, I'd have to do the math.
But yeah, yeah.
About 42. I stayed with the social media aspect, kept up with the trials like Jeff Bullock was doing, and Dominic D'Agostino came into the field of ketogenic diets, and there was other people like Thomas Siegfried from Harvard with the cancer. I've always been kind of interested in how the diet would help in that, help overall health.
All that was around in 2008, or was that later on?
Well, Dominic D'Agostino came a little bit later. He was the one who developed the very first, well, among other things, he was the very first one, him and Patrick Arnold, to develop the keto ester. They invented that, and then they went to keto salts.
Yeah.
Right. But when it all started, there was none of that. There was none of the brownies, none of that. And so I never went down that route of what I call keto junk food. I always stuck with, the eggs and meat and the cheese. And a lot of people don't do well with cheese. And if you don't do well with it, get rid of it. I've never really had a problem with it unless I decided I wanted to come down and wait a little bit, back off on the cheese. So.
You didn't have that fear of heart disease and all that crazy propaganda stuff?
No, after I'd, looked into what, like Rob Wolf, Cordain, Taubes, and all these guys were saying, obviously what I was doing was not working. I was getting high blood pressure, diabetes, overweight. So why not give this a shot? So I did. And it worked very well. And I just stuck with it for all these years. And I was telling Tom earlier, I kind of quit following the social media about 5 years ago and just got back into it in September. Hmm. Holy cow. As
exploded.
The keto and the carnivore thing has exploded.
Right? Yeah.
And then you have videos like this. Back when I used to listen to podcasts a lot, it was more like a radio. You go in, Yeah. Get on the radio, or like if I wanted to go to Mark Sisson's, Mark Daly's Apple, I'd have to go to his thing and read what he posted.
Right. So,
and a lot of the what I took from what they were saying was, back then, was if you wanted to, you had the vegetables. If you didn't, you took them away.
Well, yeah.
The GI issues were not good with vegetables. I'm not a ruminant. I don't do good with grass, you know, or wood or cellulose.
Uh-huh.
I consider fiber wood.
Right.
Pull that out. Ah, it's a lot better. You know, you feel a lot better. Well, I've stuck with the diet ever since. And guess what? I have never once got scurvy.
Never once. No scurvy, huh?
How did you do in your transition stage? I mean, did you have any issues during the first 3 months or so, or 6 weeks?
The first 2 months, basically, like, I was on a starvation diet. So whenever I began to eat something a little bit more substantial, I was just feeling good. I never went through the – oh, I went through the keto flu the first 3 months. I was actually keto because I was feeding up my own triglycerides or, you know, my own fat.
Right.
So, and then when I started eating ketogenic and then getting rid of the vegetables, so basically I was eating carnivore, zero carb. I never really went through that, but I do know a lot of times it takes some transition to get into it. I mean, if you went burning ding-dongs for so long and then all of a sudden you just go to steak, there's got to be there's a transition there. You know.
I think I felt so bad before I started that, like, when I started keto, I felt so much better. I never noticed the keto flu. I think I was still just like feeling better, better. If I got the keto flu, I never noticed. I started at the same time as my friend. We did it together. And I was like, hey, did you feel tired or sick or any symptoms? Like, maybe. I kind of felt a little sluggish the last couple of days. And well, I could have been anything. So clearly not everybody really has any substantial symptoms. So. I'm always kind of surprised because it seems like almost like the majority does. And I'm like, and it's so different than my experience. I'm always like, really? You had a flu for 2 months? What? So,
you're just lucky.
I actually expected to go through that because Jimmy Moore, he's a guy that's been into keto for quite some time. I used to listen to his podcast.
Sure.
Boy, when he went following the Atkins diet, he felt horrible, I guess, you know, that's what he was saying. And, I expected to feel really horrible, but I was already feeling horrible. Just like Tom just mentioned, he's already feeling horrible. I was already feeling horrible.
Yeah.
So my transition wasn't bad at all.
So other than weight loss, what would you say that you felt like healed up or got better?
I don't have any more diabetes whatsoever anymore. I have no
idea. Nice.
I don't got a problem. I have a post or saying my fasting glucose around 90, A1C is about 5.1. I take my blood pressure usually daily just because I'm interested. It's typically about 110 over 75.
So what sort of activity do you do on a day there? I know you said you're kind of retired. You got a little farm there. You raise some animals. I mean, what's your activity level like?
Yeah, I usually work out with resistance training. I usually work out about twice a week. Mm-hmm. And then the other times I'm out here building barns and shit. Mm-hmm. You know, like I'm doing now.
Building a barn.
Yeah, and it's February in Utah, which is pretty cold, but it's kind of slightly transitioning into spring. In other words, it's getting up to a blistering 40 degrees. Mm-hmm. So I'm able to work outside.
And when you started, you were doing some weightlifting way back when, you know.
Yeah, I've weightlifted ever since I've been about 16 years old. I got into it then, and because of the way I did it, I've suffered some health issues because of it.
Yeah.
As far as joint and back, and that was just because of the way I did it at the time. I should have never done what I did.
I had that same issue.
I've had a couple of surgeries.
Oh, you have?
Yeah. It ain't nothing to do with the diet. It was because of the reality.
Well, how did the diet do for that pain? Do you still have that?
Well, the healing process was great. I mean, I never had I had a fused disc in my lower back. I got a Claudia Squonia, I think, something like that. It's a serious, something serious. I can't remember exactly how to say it. And what happens, I was losing the feeling down to my lower extremities.
Was it Cotta Aquinas?
That's it, Cotta Aquinas.
Nevada Gray had. She got paralyzed from that.
Yeah, it'll paralyze you. I could still walk. I wasn't as bad. I remember seeing the interview. I can't remember who interviewed her, but I remember seeing that interview, and I could relate to what she was saying. Numbness in the legs, but I don't think she could walk. I could still walk with canes. And then I went in, and the next day after my surgery, I'm up walking. And it didn't take me very long to heal up from that.
Interesting. Yeah.
How do you feel now?
I feel good. I feel great.
Yeah. No back pain.
No back pain.
No. And I contribute that to the diet. It helps a lot. And I contribute that I'm not trying to. I'm trying to work my muscle more than my joints and tendons nowadays that I'm getting a little older. Put the focus on the muscle, not on the joint and the discs, things like that.
I took like almost 10 years off from the gym because I was in so much pain, and now I'm back in and I'm 49 and I can't stop lifting more and more and more because I can't believe how much I can lift. I set a new PR at 455 on the deadlift the other day, and it blew my mind. I couldn't believe I was holding that much weight, which, I mean, there's plenty of people that can do that. But for me, that was like an all-time record. I'm stronger now than I was 20 years ago, for sure. There's no doubt in my mind. Yeah.
No question about it. I'm faster, stronger, everything.
Something I've noticed about weightlifting is you're not a competitive powerlifter, you're not a competitive bodybuilder. So you're only competing against yourself.
That's right.
So that 455, that's the best you've ever done. That's outstanding.
Yeah, that's a win.
Great.
I almost didn't sleep that night. I was like, I got to go back to the gym and try it again.
Yeah. And you're wondering if you can do even more. So that's awesome.
I turned my cell phone on and recorded it for evidence because I was like, nah, nobody's gonna believe this, So, right. But I've squatted 500 too. So which I'm not exactly a small guy, so it's not much of a stretch of imagination. And that I kind of crept up on. But it's all diet. I know that like when I was half this age and I was eating the standard diet, I was even chugging the protein shakes, the whey isolate, and God forbid I don't know if you guys ever had the egg protein shakes. They're so disgusting. Choking all that stuff down, and I was miserable. My stomach was bothering me all the time. I didn't have any energy, and I was just getting fatter, and my joints just hurt more. I was miserable. And I was so heavy, Mark, that I'd get on a treadmill and it would stop. Like I'd be chugging along and the belt would just bind up and I'd go flying. And I did it over and over again. And I used to move around from different treadmills trying to find one that would work. And finally, I just had to give up because I was getting all beat up flying off of those things.
Yeah, so, you're there to build yourself, not hurt yourself.
Not hurt yourself, yeah.
I actually made a lady cry one day. I went flying off one of those machines. I hit the dashboard. Then I fell down. I stepped on the side, and then my other foot was still on the belt. And I did a face plant into the belt and flew off the back. And then I was getting dusting myself off, and the lady next to me had stopped, and she was looking at me. She's just bawling. She's like, I can't believe that this has happened to you. I was helpless. I couldn't do anything for you. I feel so bad. I'm like, oh, I do it all the time.
The common experience.
I don't know. It's crazy. You go to the gym and you work out and you eat all the stuff they tell you to eat. I was eating lean chicken breast and brown rice and spinach and, on and on and on, doing everything they said. And meanwhile, I'm just getting sicker and fatter. And I'm going to the gym 5 days a week, working out like an animal, and I'm just going down the toilet, It's rough.
Speaking of, what did your doctor say about this whole diet transition? Because you went for metformin earlier on, and then did you ever go back to him?
I went back to him, and it was done. It was negative. because my cholesterol is high. But the very, and I've been told, well, you're going to have a heart attack every time for the last 10 years. I've been, 12 years, I'm going to have a heart attack because my LDL is high, even though my blood pressure is just fine. Everything else is right in line. I mean, the Framington Heart Study, for some reason, LDL got, it got somehow put up in the spotlight. And if you don't have any of these other ones, but it was all negative. I just recently, I went back in September, I went and I was with a doctor, new doctor I never seen before. And he said, well, your LDL is high. And I said, well, okay, well, I follow a ketogenic diet. We really have no idea what a high LDL on a ketogenic diet means. And he's the first MD that's ever said that.
Wow, he actually admitted that. That's great.
Yeah, I've never heard that before.
Yeah, that's great.
If you want a statin, I'll give you a statin. If you don't, then I won't.
Great.
I really don't know what it means.
That's good. I noticed the doctors are softening up. I belong to a big healthcare system, and they even send out emails talking about things like keto and low carb now. So, and my doctor was cool with it. The one I have now, I take him books to read and he reads them. So I took him good calories, bad calories. And then I took him that one from Dr. Boz. She's a keto doctor. Her mom had cancer and she put the whole family on a keto diet because one of her patients was asking her about this keto diet and she didn't know anything about it. So she researched it. Now she's a big keto advocate. So I take books like that to my doctor and just drop them off. I haven't needed to see my doctor for a long time. So I think the healthcare field's opening up slowly to these sort of extreme diets. So
it's a bottom up type of approach because it's like the doctors, they're going with what they're told. I can't believe how many will say, yes, you are definitely going to die. You're going to have a heart attack. Well, how do they know? Because who's telling you that? You know?
That's right.
Because, I had people telling me, doctors back then who tell me, no, you're not. You know, Michael Aids and all. Rob Wolf's not a doctor, but very knowledgeable.
Yeah.
Lauren Cordain and Gary Taubes, nobody did any research like he did back at that point. And he had Georgia Eads, who's a psychologist. Yeah. She's still around.
And her husband's an MD, right?
Yeah. And now you got
Georgia Eads? I didn't know that.
Yeah, Michael Eads. He's a.
Oh, no, Michael Eads. No. Georgia Eads. They're different.
They're not married.
No, Georgia Eads is a psychiatrist, and Michael Eads does have a wife that's also an MD. That's right.
Oh, okay.
But they're not related.
All right.
And I think her name does start with a G too.
Georgia.
Yeah, I think it starts with a G.
Georgia. Yeah.
Because when they come out with Protein Power, it was way back.
Yeah, Protein Power.
In the late 90s.
Yeah.
I think she was one of the authors on it.
You're right. She was.
Okay.
And I have that book. So, yeah.
Yeah. I actually, that was my very first book. I was stuck in an airport with no luggage. You know, one of those things where I got bounced off a flight and my luggage traveled. And so I was stuck and I was like, what am I going to do? And I saw that book, Protein Power, for sale. So I sat down and started reading it. And that was my first sort of foray into sort of low carb, but I didn't know anybody else who did it. I didn't really know what I was doing. I didn't really even understand nutrition. So I kind of made some gains and then kind of gave up because I was just eating too much sugar and flour and stuff at the time. So, but I had a cavity that remineralized and my eyesight had gotten better. And that kind of piqued my interest.
Yeah, that would.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, Mary Eads. Yeah, Mary Eads is her name.
Mary Eads. We go.
Yeah.
So the one thing back when I first got into it, a lot of people were still a little bit nervous about the saturated fat thing. Everybody was on with the monos and starting to come on with the fish oils and things like that. But then you had other guys out there saying there's nothing wrong with saturated fat. And I think they always had the war between the grain fed and the grass fed.
It's still raging.
It's still raging. Yeah. It's still going. And I don't know. I've eaten both.
Did you take supplements during your journey?
Me?
Yeah.
During my actual dieting back, since 2008, no, but I've taken all kinds of
supplements. Yeah. Before that, I knew that. Yeah. But I meant during your carnivore.
No. I learned prior to that that you can look and you can find you're deficient in all kinds of stuff people are going to want to sell you. You can spend your whole paycheck on supplements and vitamins, CoQ10, whatever, protein powders, this herb, that herb. No. It gets real tiring after a while.
No doubt.
So give us an idea what you eat. What do you eat in a typical day, Mark?
Well, I ate once today already, and I had today I had roast beef so far. And tonight I'll have the same. What happens is my wife will usually cook like twice a week. So, when I have it, it'll be like lamb chops or lamb steaks or something to do with lamb. Or when I'm out of that, it'll be some kind of beef, and I usually eat about twice a day, usually about 9 or 10.
And, do you need any extra roast beef when you're building a barn as opposed to their other days?
I don't ever pay attention. I just throw it on a plate, and well, that looks like enough, and then I'll eat it, and then if I feel good, then I'll quit eating. Usually at night, though, I find I'm more hungry at night than the day. I don't know why. But it tends to be I'm more hungry at night, so I'll eat more at night. But I still eat. I'd have to say it's probably about 3/4 to a pound during the day, and at night it's probably about 1.5 to 2. I need to weigh it so I can actually tell exactly what it is.
Yeah.
So right now I'm just throwing it on the plate, warming it up.
So, Do you fast at all?
I have tried fasting. I have. Me and Peter Attia is totally different in our fasting. He don't count it a fasting unless you've done it a week. If you know what Peter Attia is.
Yeah, I do. Yeah.
Unless you're hitting a week, you ain't fasting.
Yeah.
But if you're talking like one meal a day, then I've done that. And that's fine. I just feel better on twice. I just feel better on it.
Yeah.
And then you got. Something I've noticed since I've started visit, you got a big war between mTOR and autophagy. That wasn't really all that. They weren't talking about this like 10 years ago.
Right.
Now you got, I'm going to start mTOR. I'm going to pull cancer. No, you're not going to grow either. You're going to feel miserable. Autophagy. I want to be in autophagy all the time where I'm, rebuilding, reusing this and that. How long do you expect to stay in autophagy and stay there forever until you die?
Until you eat yourself completely.
until you don't eat, you just starve yourself right to death. I can see the fact that you probably don't want to eat like bodybuilders. When I was in bodybuilding, 6 meals a day was, where you were at, what I was trying to get to. I don't think there's any need for that either, to be honest. Eat when you're hungry, don't when you're not. Once you've adjusted to the diet. If you're brand new to it, if you're new and you're hungry, you eat.
Eat
until you become totally keto adapted, burning meat or, meat, fat, protein, whatever your body's preferring that, to get out of that nutrient. And then wait till you convert to it, and then you'll just gradually go to once, one or two times a day. I think in that you just go to. But when you begin, you eat whenever you're hungry, you eat plenty.
You ever had any meetups with Kelly Hogan, Dr. Lisa, or any of the long timers, Charles Washington or Andersons?
I never knew like that. I was out of the social media part for about 5 years. So I didn't really know who Kelly Hogan, Lisa Weidman, like the yogi, the carnivore yoga girl.
Yeah.
I didn't know who these are. The nutrition with
Judy.
Judy. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Nutrition with Judy. I didn't know any of these. Because the, like I said, the social media wasn't like where you could see people. It was you go and you go to their website, or you, it's like radio. And I stayed with the people that mostly that were like Jeff Bullock, who was actually working for a university who's doing studies, Steve Finney, guys like this. I was reading their stuff, Gary Tobbs. So I stuck with the, you know, reading their thing, and I didn't get a lot of, involved in different blogs. And I should have. You
know? So you didn't really get into anecdotes either, like seeing other people's stories that could get you keep on going and stuff, or what?
I should have, because I didn't need it. All I needed was, I was really interested in the medical, the health advantages of it, as well as I was really interested in. So, you know, I'd read about like people like Eric Westman, how he had so much success in diabetes, and then Jeff Bullock, like I said, and Dominic D'Agostino later with his Angela Poff works for him, and Angela Poff's in the cancer, and some of these other cancer doctors that were having some success with keto dieting. So I read mostly their stuff. So, I should have gotten the blogs. I didn't really understand what blogs were, though. And I understand it more now.
It's a different technology now. So yeah. I understand. Yeah.
I'm not really a tech wizard. Although I got on here without any problems. I was amazed. All I did was click and follow the arrow. And boy, I was on. It was easy.
I'm not really a wizard either. And I managed to pull these videos off. So.
Yeah, so, Tom, you the man.
Did you notice any difference? Like when you started, you know, eating a carnivore style diet, in like how frequently you got a cold or the flu or any sort of seasonal allergies or anything like that?
Yes. Huge. I should have mentioned that before. I cannot remember the last time I was actually sick like that. I don't remember last time I had the flu. I don't remember last time I had a cold.
Probably more than 10 years ago.
I know, right?
I cannot remember any of that. I remember what they felt like. I remember what the chills felt like, the fever, the, you know, getting that. But I have not had one that I can remember in years. Nothing, no cold. And the allergies, they used to be so bad. My eyes used to swell up all puffy and watery.
That was me.
Hives sometimes on your skin. And sometimes I get a little bit, in the spring, I'll get a little bit. In the eyes, it ain't bad. It's nothing compared to me. Nothing at all. So, yeah, that health benefit that way has been really tremendous. It's been super.
Yeah, I had the same experience. I remember the last time I got sick was like 3 Christmases ago. I was doing my little transition back to keto. I tried carnivore, and I got a sore throat. And I just fasted while I had the sore throat, because I figured, why eat when your throat hurts, right? Then it went away, and that was the last time I got sick, and I haven't been sick in over 2 years. And I used to get the cold, the seasonal cold and flu, like everybody else. I used to have terrible allergies. I used to take all this allergy medication. You know, it seemed like you get an allergy, then you get a sinus infection, then it goes to your chest. You know, it was like go through that cycle all the time. My whole life, and then go carnivore, and it's like your immune system is finally working the way it's supposed to, right? And that's why I you know, we could talk all day about, you know, cancer cells and oncogenes and on and on and on, but I kind of think that what's going on is your immune system just is working better, and your immune system kills cancer just like it kills germs, you know. Right. So I suspect that that's really what's going on, is that we're just finally on a diet where our immune system isn't compromised by all these non-natural foods, you know. It's running on fat and protein, you know, substantial amounts of the right amino acids and the right fats. But that's just me speculating.
How was your social aspect of all this? I mean, like as far as wife, children, whatever, family. How'd that go for you?
For me?
Yeah.
I'm married.
And is she carnivore?
Not like me. No, nope. I haven't been able to really affect the people that are closest to me, to buy into this. Kind of, maybe it's like an MD trying to tell his parents what to do. They ain't gonna listen to him. I'm kind of in the same boat. I have had other people come to me, and they've had great success with it. Some of them were amazed because I don't have any degree or nothing. And I would advise them, you really want to lose weight? Okay, well, here's how you do it. Boom, it works every time. And that's usually what people come for, is to weight loss. And it worked.
So you were able to convince a lot of other people.
Yeah.
That's great. That's great.
Yeah. Now, I don't know how many actually stayed to it, stuck with it.
Right.
The draw to them donuts is pretty high. Everybody wants their donut. But, after a while, being this way, I don't have that super. I remember the urge to go grab that big Krispy Kreme donut and go to town. I don't really have that anymore so much.
Well, that brings up that question. So when you saw the results, were you ever thinking at one point that, I'm going to add a little bit of this next time and start adding carb foods? Did you ever have that thought process?
Yeah, I got that from Atkins. When I ever would try it, I'd immediately, and I have experimented some, but not more than like 2 weeks a shot. Add me some oatmeal in. Yeah, that's good stuff. This is years ago, though. Yeah, this is long, around the beginning. You start adding that in, and next thing you know, I'm 6 foot now, about 200 pounds. Next thing you know, you go to weigh yourself next week, you're 210. You're like, Then 215. No, this ain't working out for me. Something I've never been able to do, though, Raymond, is I've never been able to get my six pack.
Well, I do fasting, so that's the way to do it. Yeah.
I'll have to give that a good shot.
Yeah. Well, do you eat any dairy, Mark? Other than
I eat cheese.
You still eat cheese? When, nice. What kind of cheese?
And that's it. Mostly cheddar cheese.
Yeah.
I'll grab that, throw it on my roast beef or mix on my eggs.
My neighbor's dog is barking up a storm. So if you guys hear it and it's too loud, let me know. I'll mute my mic again.
That's fine.
Go ahead. If people have any problems with the casein proteins or anything in cheese, which I don't seem to have in digestion wise, it ain't worth it. Give it up. Yeah. I mean, even back then, back in the 2000s, and people were talking about dairy may not be the best. I gave up milk. You drink milk and you're going to gain weight.
Yeah.
I mean, look at the calf. Gains weight pretty quick.
That makes sense. Yeah. No, you're right. How about coffee? You do coffee, Mark?
I drink coffee. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. People will see how healthy I eat, right? And then they'll see me down a diet drink. And they'll say, well, what's healthy in that? I mean, there's absolutely nothing. There's nothing healthy in this diet Dr. Pepper, this cup of coffee, or this no-carb energy monster I'm drinking. There's absolutely nothing healthy in it. I just like them. Sometimes I'll indulge in them.
Mm. Right. Do you ever have any negative side effects from, say, energy drinks that you've tried?
I'm lucky in that way, I guess. I don't.
That's great. That's great.
I've never felt any negative from coffee or the energy drinks.
Yeah.
I'm lucky in that. If I did, I would not.
Yeah, of course you would give it up. Yeah, no doubt. Yeah. And right. I'm guessing you probably don't do much of that as far as energy drink. Coffee probably every day, right?
Yeah, in the mornings I'll get have my coffee. Mm-hmm. And I usually have stevia in it, but I don't know if it matters. I'm not so convinced that stevia or sucralose or even the one that's supposed to be really bad for you, the two amino acids stuck together, very first Aspartame. I don't know if you have a little of that in your coffee. I don't know if it's, unless it's bothering you, then don't have it.
Right, right. Obviously, it's not throwing you off. So, I mean.
Yeah, so. But I'll be the one to first tell you, what does it add? It adds absolutely zero.
Right, right. Right. It's not for health you're doing that, right? Yeah. Just enjoyment, right.
Just enjoyment.
Yeah.
As far as eating, though, it's strictly pretty carnivore, except for, I know the cheese might be a little iffy.
No.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, dairy is complicated. It just depends on the person and what we're talking about, because butter is different than cheese, and cheese is different from milk, and milk's different from cream, and A1's different from A2, and raw is different from homogenized and pasteurized.
And you complicate even more, and then you add eggs, because that's dairy, so that gets all complicated. Yeah,
and Mark and I were talking before, but he was telling about the quality of eggs, you know, how you can tell whether it's really a free-range chicken, you know, or not. There's a big difference, and he was making the same complaint I have about you buy like I buy these frozen ducks sometimes because I can't, it's hard to get duck, and they always say vegetarian fed on them, you know.
Yeah.
It's like, poor duck, isn't he supposed to eat snails and stuff? Come on.
Right.
Yeah, I raised ducks and chickens, and it was like Tom was saying, they'll eat mice, you know, they'll go after the rats.
Wow.
The grasshoppers, they are not vegetarians.
Right.
Yeah, that was kind of what I wanted to ask about more. It was about your animals. You know, I'm kind of curious, like, which animals you raise, which ones you eat, how they mix together, you know, is there like, keep them separate, or you know, what kind of numbers and how much effort you put into it, all that?
I probably got about I probably got about 30 chickens running around out there total, about 10 geese, about 5 ducks, some peacocks, and a couple of turkeys. And I've raised bought and raised turkeys and butchered them. They're hard to raise. They want to die whenever they like to die when they just die. But chicks are the easiest, meat chickens. I've raised them, and they're fairly easy to. I've raised over like 100 to 150 at a shot, and then butchered them all, and I just filled up my own freezer with them.
You do your own butchering?
What's that?
You do your own butchering?
Yeah. Well, nice. I do with the chickens. When it comes to the sheep, no, I take them in. I don't know. I don't know what I'm doing. I wasn't raised on a farm. I was actually raised in Salt Lake City, and there's no room for any of this kind of stuff. I moved 30 miles out of Salt Lake. And it's not real rural, but it's more rural where you can still own animals. And I raise my sheep now. And well, I raise the chickens for the eggs, and they're good. I like them better than the turkeys and chickens, because I really don't like chicken breast and turkey breast. Lamb chops, real good.
What's the peacock for? The peacock?
Absolutely nothing. My wife names them.
Okay, I just wanted to ask, are you eating the peacock too?
peacock, he ain't very big in the first place.
Right.
And it takes so long to grow up too. I mean, you know, you see them big blue ones with the big long tails.
Yeah.
They're probably 4 or 5 years old, and it takes them that long to get there.
Wow.
I wouldn't be eating them. Where a turkey, you raise them for like 6 months, and they're 6-7 months, and some of them toms will be up to around 40 pounds.
Have you guys ever seen that TV show Fantasy Island?
Yeah.
Okay, so the beginning of that shot at this place we have here called the Arboretum. It's basically like a tree museum, right? Where you go look at all these trees and plants. It's in Arcadia, California, which is kind of on the outskirts of LA. And they have all these peacocks running around there. Now, that place has been there longer than I've been alive. So these peacocks have spread out into the surrounding areas, and they're everywhere. So they live in people's backyards. You hear them screaming all the time. And I always wondered, it's like, yeah, there's an awful lot of them. Somebody has to be eating those things, because
right,
there's something. Just too many of them.
Yeah, there's too many.
But I know Mark was saying they're good like at eating mice and stuff like that, right? The peacocks?
Yeah, I've actually seen them actually stalk mice.
Wow.
Creep up on them and nail them. So, and they got these little things called pocket gophers around here. They're like, basically they're a rat or a gopher type. And they'll stop in. I don't have very many of them in my lawn. So that's probably.
Very good. Yeah, somebody posted a picture of a fox diving through the snow after a vole. I didn't even know what a vole was. But this fox just did this, like, jump up and straight down into a hole. Like, half his body went down this hole after this little animal. So
he nosedived in.
I can imagine peacock with that long neck is pretty handy at grabbing those critters out of the hole.
Yeah, they are. Yeah. And then when grabs one, actually, then all the rest of them will chase them around the yard, trying to get their peace. So.
What was your reasoning to start a farm?
It was always something I kind of wanted to try to do. I always had kind of an interest in it. And I had an interest, but I actually didn't actually get started in it until about 5 years ago. And that's when I really started raising the chickens. And before that, I was buying grass-fed beef from people around the area. But there's something in that, too, because if you go to a grass-fed farm, we're going to charge you premium dollar. If you go to a rancher whose cow's out on the range, and they're going to bring him in and take him to the sale, which then they'll go to the stockyard, where they beef them up. You go there and you buy the cow straight from the farmer like that. It's grass fed and it's been running around in the mountains and on pasture. And then you take them down to a butcher who takes it from a live animal down to packaging it. You're going to get a lot. It's a lot cheaper to do that.
That makes sense.
That's a good tip right there.
Yeah,
good
really. Pro tip. So you actually buy the actual cow, mm-hmm. take it to the butcher and yourself, and then handle it out.
Usually you can. You can arrange with that because a rancher's going to have a trailer.
Right.
So you can arrange with them normally to go drop that cow off at the butcher's, and then that butcher will take it from alive to the steak. And you're not paying this. Last time I checked for a whole cow, it was like $3,500 to $4,000 from a grass-fed farm that advertises it as grass-fat-fed. Right. It's the same thing. They're coming right off the range. And you're just bypassing the feedlot.
Excellent.
That is a nice tip. That is really good.
Yeah, we're actively working on a plan to try and hook up the public with their local farmers, because I would think that the interest in, particularly grass-fed, local farm, family farm sort of operations are going to do nothing but grow. And so we're just kind of trying to figure out how to network people together, or maybe get people, each person in their own area to start, talking to people and getting buyers and, producers together.
Yeah, they've been talking about doing that for, people have been talking about supporting their local ranchers and farmers for years. And if more and more people get into it, the more and more that'll happen.
Yeah.
So back to your animals there. I mean, how many of these animals can live together, and how many of them have to be separated and stuff like that?
Run most of them together.
Oh, yeah.
They tell you don't run the turkeys with the chickens or don't run the chicken with the ducks, but I don't find any. It's not like one's going to sit there and pick on the other too much. They don't beat each other up too much. And the sheep can come right in with them. And, I don't really have to separate them. At all. And then I'm lucky because my whole place is fenced and let them out. Nobody leaves the yard but my peacocks. They are a pain. They're a pheasant is what they are.
They're giant pheasants. They can
fly like a pheasant. And they'll go over to the neighbor's house.
Sit on the neighbor's roof and scream at everybody.
They do.
Yeah, we have a problem with them nesting on air conditioners here. They'll build a nest around the top of somebody's condenser, and then you're supposed to leave them alone till they're hatched, so you can't run your air conditioning.
Oh, no.
You mean like the central air on the ground?
Yeah.
See, if they're on the roof, I'm wondering how them chicks are going to get off that roof,
Yeah.
The chick can't fly when they're born. But, I don't have any problem running all my animals together. And But one thing I was very pleasantly pleased with was, I never raised animals before, so I was a little bit nervous of cows, because you get hit by a cow, you're going to be put in the hospital. You get hit by a sheep, which I have been, you may not end up in the hospital. I didn't. You got to be careful with the rams, the male sheep, because they'll try to hit you.
Ram you?
That's where the name comes from, right?
Here I am, I'm out in my field, I'm petting this ram, being all his friend and everything, and I knew nothing. And that's the wrong answer. You don't touch them things, because it's a submissive. And he tried nailing me a couple of times. He hit my wife. Wow. Center point.
Damn.
After that, it's kind of, you better watch him. Don't turn your back on him.
Oh, wow. I'm good
Interesting.
To know.
Yeah. Yeah, I know a lot of, particularly the Angus cows, when they're young, they're pretty rambunctious. I've seen them. They like jumping around and running and stuff. Yeah, I wouldn't want to be in a pen full of those guys by myself.
And I don't know enough about that, raising them. I don't know how to get out of the way, like if somebody's been doing it since they've been 17, 18.
Yeah.
That's why I kind of chose sheep, is because they're smaller. And I was very well pleased with how they taste. For the lamb chops and lamb steak, the lamb burger, you can sausage them. It's really good.
So how many is it feasible for you to manage? And is you just limited by your space, or?
I'm limited. I own 3 acres, I don't want to run them on dust and feed them hay. I actually want to have them out on pasture. Right now, I got about 16 ewes, female sheep, and I'm starting to have lambs now. They're starting to put out lambs. In fact, I had to call DLS, Division of Lamb Services, on one of the ewes. She wasn't taking care of her lambs, and she's beating them up. So out she went. I had to put them in foster care. In other words, I'm the DLS guy, and I'm the foster care. And I'm bottle feeding these 2 lambs. And I got to do that every 4 hours for 3 months.
Really?
A lot of work.
Yeah, it takes a lot of time. She did it to me last year. It was the first time she had them. And so I had to do it last year with them. And I told her, you do it again, you want to go out and party with your friends out here and not take care of kids. Well, next year it's going to cost you to do it. She did it again. And she'll be made into lamb sausage.
Good answer there.
Yeah. Well, we got to cull the herd once in a while.
That's right. That's right.
Yep.
Now, from what I understand, when you got like chickens and geese and stuff like that, I'd assume peacocks, they do a good job of getting rid of some of the parasites that are in the ruminants. So the birds will pick through and find the stuff that the ruminants excrete. And if there's any worms or anything in there, the birds eat them up and kind of take them out of the cycle.
That could be. I'm not really experienced with that. They do scratch through them like that. I need to find out more about the natural way of worming. Right now, I worm them with a normal wormer about 2 or 3 times a year. I'll throw it out there. It's a pellet form, and I'll worm them. I don't even know if
I guess it's Savannah and
Hayes. We should get you a copy of our buddy's book. She wrote all about this. I haven't read it yet, but Raymond's been reading her book. Nitty's book. Ray,
I have it. Yeah.
So we should send. I'm gonna see if I can send you a copy of it, Mark, so you can check
or
it out.
Even if you just send me the author's her name again, I'll look at it. But I'd be interested in reading it myself.
Yeah.
Get the book.
Yeah, it's. I haven't finished reading it yet, but I'm reading it right now. But let me send you her name in the book.
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah, because she's all about regenerative farming, and she's.
I'm trying to get into that. Of course, I got very small regenerative farming, 3 acres.
Right.
But I do have it where I've done a lot of work on the place. I've got a pump where I can water it, and I've seeded the whole thing again this year with grass seed. So hopefully that'll be popping up here pretty quick. I'm anxious to see how that works out.
Yeah, we're anxious too. You have to send us some pictures.
Yeah. I ain't got a lamb in here right now. I can hold him up.
Next time. We'll do another video. Maybe you could just walk around and show us.
Yeah, that's it. That'd be cool.
I try to use my phone.
Yeah. Speaking of, how's vegetarian or vegan response been to you saying anything or doing anything? Has there been any issues for you?
I've never had much to do with them. I've been involved with them at work. So, I've never been involved with the real crazy ones that you see on social media. Maybe it's because I didn't pay attention to them. I don't, you do what you want, I'll do it. But I tell you what, I noticed it's coming, it's harder, or it's getting more exposure than it used to. You know, I remember like when Eric Westman and T. Colin Campbell, they'd have their debates on.
Right.
And I remember Gary Taubes and, well, what's the Dr. Oz?
Yeah. Oz,
and Dean Ornish, they were going
out. Yeah, Ornish.
Great.
And, but now, either it's getting more exposure or people are just getting more crazy. You got Loma Linda, and you got, they're trying to get the diet for the whole world.
Yeah.
Who is that? It's
Seventh-day Adventist. Yeah.
Seventh-day Adventist.
Yeah.
Then you got that.
And that billionaire lady.
Yeah, lady. That's exactly what I was thinking about. Like, the name of that company.
Yeah.
That she's started up. And
they got that Eat Lancet study.
And then you got people like it was always like I seen Gary Taubes on Oz, and some of these guys don't do the best when they're trying to debate. Do quite the best. I wish he would, but you know, they hammer him. The worst I've seen was Saladino. When he was on that doctor.
Gosh, the recent one. Yeah, that was
the drama queens.
Well, that was the worst.
That was the worst.
And then they got the people down there who applaud, you know, clap.
You know, it looked like it was totally staged. I'm sure they had an applause thing, and then that's because I was like, this is ridiculous. Nobody would applaud for some of the stupid things they did.
Right.
That was really, really bad. I thought that was horrible. Yeah. That was total entertainment. There was no health.
Yeah.
They weren't trying to get anything out of that. It was just, especially the.
I honestly think they embarrassed themselves. The doctors did.
Yeah.
At this point, that was how bad it was.
Oh, it was horrible.
I was like, oh my God, I can't believe they're actually willing to risk themselves like that. But the good for us in a way.
We do hear about these stories of people like, yeah, the first time I went to such and such an expo and spoke, I was like a pariah. And then a few years later, they had me back and they treated me like a conquering hero. So, you know, you got to get that message out there. I don't know if you Cole Robinson, the snake diet guy.
Yeah, I did. I saw his on Doctor.
He was on the Doctors as well. And they just massacred him on there. And just, you know, screamed and yelled at him and told him he was killing people or whatever. And you know, I've done my experiment with fasting. I think fasting is a powerful tool, and I'm not like a huge advocate for it, but I think it has its place. And, but the thing is, that guy is changing people's lives.
He's changing. That's what I was going to say. He's healing people.
He motivates people. He yells and screams at them and cusses at them. And he's got this whole persona he's invented just to motivate people. And he's really turning their lives around. I'm sure he's saving people's lives.
We're talking about 500-pound plus people he's actually changing around. We're not talking about small people, you know? So amazing.
He's a big on dieting. Is that what he's big on?
Fasting, long fast.
Fasting.
Yeah, he's a fasting guy. Yeah.
Dry fasting and fasting, both.
I mean, he gets into some crazy stuff like drinking urine. But in general, just the fast, teaching people to fast. My first fast was 12 days, and I went 12 days because I couldn't believe I could do it. I was like, this, how come I'm not dying? You know, and you read about people doing it, and you learn about it, and you're like, well, I got to try this.
Right.
So.
Well, there's that one guy who I don't know, it weighed like 400 pounds. It went a year.
Yeah, a year.
Yeah. Angus Barbary.
Yeah, he's probably the longest recorded, medically recorded fast.
383 days, I think it was.
Yeah.
Nothing but multivitamin and water.
Yeah.
Something like that.
That's right.
I wonder why is they didn't just, you know, sarcopenia up because of lack of protein. I don't know. Maybe his body was, I don't know. The ketones are, you know, muscle sparing. I've heard that. It had to be something like that.
Mark, yeah. There's a lot that's, I mean, you know, this is pretty much kind of pointing at Emperor's Got No Clothes kind of thing, because there's so much that the science don't understand about the human body.
Well, he clearly would have lost a lot of muscle because he didn't need it anymore, right? So when you, let's say you weigh 380 pounds or whatever. I used to weigh probably 360. So you need a lot of, you know, muscle and larger joint tissue and everything else in order just to support that weight and walk around. So when you start losing weight, you're going to burn some of that protein, if anything, because your body's like, I don't need it anymore. Unless he upped his exercise and was, you know, stimulating muscle growth, his body's going to get rid of it anyway. So a lot of that
protein, stayed home most of the time.
So, and the rest, he's just burning fat, you know, for fuel.
Yeah,
so,
fat for fuel.
Right.
I mean, that's one of the reasons, like, I'm trying to get leaner, but I'm also trying to put on muscle. And so, like, when I go walking, I wear a weight vest. So I can, you know, my body doesn't detect the there's this idea that your, particularly like the bones in your legs, sort of detect how much pressure you're using to move around, and that regulates bone density and muscle and everything else to some degree. So I add weight on just to make my body think I'm heavier than I am. So
yeah. Are you following a higher protein, lower fat, or what? How are you, Tom? How are you trying to?
I'm shifting higher protein these days. I mean, it came from a keto diet, you know, originally where it was high fat, and then kind of, yeah. I was kind of like in that middle zone where I think most people are comfortable, or it's kind of 50-50 protein to fat. I did the PKD diet because I still had psoriasis. There's a paleo ketogenic diet from Hungary. From paleo medicine, I got some help from them, and then that's very high fat meat based. It's all meat, but they include like brains and liver and bone marrow, typically in that diet. And I did that to manage psoriasis, and then now I started weightlifting and really enjoy the weightlifting more. I mean, I just love to lift, so I still want to get leaner. So I'm shifting towards more protein. So I'm trying to get in that higher protein ratio where I'm probably going to shoot for like 1.5 grams of protein for a body weight, and probably low, like 0.3, 0.5 grams of fat per pound of body weight.
A little less energy, a little more protein.
Yeah. Cause I got plenty of fat to burn. So
what's that lady's name from paleo Medicina? She comes on a lot of podcasts,
Sophia
Clements.
Yes.
Yeah.
I have a hard time understanding her because her Hungarian accent is so heavy. But.
Right.
Yeah, my ex-wife was Hungarian, so I was used to listen to her parents had a thick accent. So, in fact, they learned to speak English in Australia. So her dad, talk about it was like Count Chocula met Crocodile Dundee. You know, and then you put a couple beers in him because he was an avid beer drinker, and it was like you really had to concentrate to figure out what he was saying sometimes. So,
I would have loved to hear that.
Yeah,
that's pretty good. I like how the dieting way is not just in America; it's all over America. It's all over the world.
Yeah, and,
you know, right. Right.
I mean. Tim Noakes had issues.
South Africa.
In South Africa, Australia, New Zealand, you had Gary
Fetke.
I think Zoe Holmcrombie has had some problems too. And there's another Swedish doctor. They're all taken to the boards, all exonerated.
Yeah.
It's all over the place. You're like Paul Mason's in Australia.
Right.
You got a lot of.
Do you know Bart Kay is?
I do not.
Bart was a lecturer, a university lecturer and a researcher. And he's from New Zealand, but he was working in Great Britain. And he finally got fed up and left. And now he's a YouTube podcaster guy. I think he calls himself the science watchdog or something. Nutrition science watchdog is what he calls himself. He's quite a character. I've done some videos with him. And he's making quite a ruckus in New Zealand these days. And then we got our buddy Joe Zumbos in Sydney, Australia. He's a chef. And he's kind of linking together with other carnivores there. And we did a podcast recently with a guy in Iceland, Ivor Osford.
What means?
He's a chef too.
Oh, not now. Okay, I was thinking Ivor Cummings.
Yeah, the Irishman. Yeah. So he's not quite carnivore yet, Ivor Cummings, but I'm working on him. I'm working on him.
Good.
Yeah, just tell him to eat his lamb and his beef and leave the vegetables out. You know?
Yeah.
Hey, that brings up a topic. Has Gary Tobbs ever gone carnivore?
I don't know. We should bug him. Maybe we should try.
No, you're right.
Would you guys like to podcast with Gary Taubes? And maybe we should just start extending the invitation.
Are you kidding? Heck yeah.
Talk to Gary. Yeah. Talk to Ivor. I love Ivor Cummings. He's got the greatest accent. I listen to him talk all day.
And he's really came on with the cholesterol thing since about, I don't know when he came on in the scene, probably about 2010, 2011.
A little later than that, right?
A little later than that.
Yeah.
Have you ever had a...
Have
you ever had a calcium artery score mark? You have?
I've had two of them.
Oh.
I've had two of them. And I had one about 6 years ago. And then I recently had one. I had zero. I'm at zero.
You're at zero. Excellent. Yeah, I had mine done about a year ago, and I'm at eight. But Ray had his done. He's a little higher, Ray. What was your CAC score?
700. Yeah. For my age, it's really bad. So I'm 47. So.
But Ray lost a lot of weight now. So.
Oh, yeah.
The way I understand it is, and you guys probably know as much as I do or more, is let's say kind of I have a 700. Mm-hmm. Well, as long as that don't turn into a 900, you're good to go.
You know, I couldn't care less. I'm still staying on the diet.
As long as you go to a 9 to a 12.
Yeah.
You know,
it could be 20,000.
You're going before you started the diet.
That's right. This thing takes a long time to manifest. So you can't tell me, well, like my nurse was trying to convince me. He was like, you probably got that 1 year carnivore that you did. I'm like, dude,
no.
This takes freaking years to develop. I'm like, years, you know. You think 1 year is going to do anything? Whatever.
Yeah.
We're starting to hear more and more reports from people whose calcium scores are going down on carnivore. So
it's amazing because, that was, before just recently, that was supposed to be impossible.
Of course,
they're going by this SAD diet, standard American diet. And
that's
of course,
impossible
it's
there,
gonna be
yeah.
progressive. And it,
right.
it's going to be progressive.
Right.
They need to do it on. I'd like to see them do it on the carnivores, throw keto in there, do the SAD diet in there, and throw the vegans in there also. And
why
then
not?
All of them have a CAT scan score and then see where it goes.
That's it.
So how did you hear about the calcium artery scoring? Did you just do that on your own or did your doctor recommend it?
Ivor is pretty big on that, right? Is that where you heard it from, Mark?
I am fairly certain I heard about it from Ivor Cummings. And then I looked into it, and then I got it. Yeah, when he first came on the scene, he was always been big on the from what I can remember, the CAT scan.
Yeah.
And
now
he's even super bigger on it. But it was the very first one I think I heard about it. It made sense. I mean, go see what kind of buildup you got in the heart.
Was it easy?
I didn't realize it had been around since about the 80s.
Was it easy for you to find a place to have it done, and was it affordable?
It actually was.
Yeah.
It was. It was about $100, and it was actually very easy to find. Yeah, no prescription needed. Just go have it done. And the same with blood work. If you sometimes, although my doctor, when last time I went in, I just go in for blood work. She gave me the sheet. She marked it off, and then she gives me the sheet to take to the lab. Well,
yeah.
couple more things got marked on that.
Ticked a couple boxes, did you?
Yeah.
Sneaky devil. A
couple more boxes got marked. So, but you can go have your own blood work done, like from Quest.
Yeah.
That's in the past. I've had it done through Quest. Now there's probably a whole bunch more online you can just go to.
Yeah. Oh, the way it works in California is you find an out-of-state doctor who has like a service, and you just you literally shop for the test. Like you go from one guy's site to another, and it'll be Ultralab or whatever, and you go on there, and you're like, "How much is this?" Oh, okay. Let me get this one, this one, this one, and then you just go to the local, you know, Quest Lab or Lab Corp office, and they draw the blood, and somebody emails you the results. Cause like a lot of the stuff they wanted me to do at Paleo Medicina, my healthcare provider didn't even offer those tests. And since I'm always curious of what's going on with my blood, I was, "Hey doc, test this, test that." And pretty soon I was out of tests. They're like, "Yeah, we're not doing any more lab work for you, buddy. You don't need all this." And so I have to go outside and pay out of pocket. So.
Yeah. My very last one was a couple months ago, and I was interested in vitamin D. They didn't have a vitamin C level and magnesium, and I figured potassium would be just fine. But I had them all and different ones. I had the LDL high density screening, particle screening also done.
Oh, okay.
I was just curious, my own curiosity. But everything was normal, well, except for my LDL. It's high.
Right.
Well, it's 190. I've had it before where my total cholesterol has been up to 400.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
And I still didn't worry about it.
I was on carnivore. Okay.
At that particular time, and I don't do it anymore, because I'd call quote fast, but it wasn't fasting. What I'd do is I'd have coffee all day. Just have coffee. But I had my heavy cream. And my triglycerides, when I went and got checked on that, and that's what stopped me. It was over 200 when I was doing the heavy cream. And I thought, yeah, something's wrong here. So I figured that is the heavy cream. So there went the heavy cream out. Now triglycerides are about 80 right now. It's not where I'd like them, but it's
it's not a bad number.
Not 250. Yeah.
Right. Do you have any idea what your HDL is roughly?
Yeah,
it was about 60. I've always run on the kind of the lower end for HDL. I don't know why that was. I typically run anywhere from 40 to 60, depending on.
Yeah, I think anything 40 and over is good.
Yeah, I was okay with it. Well, I was okay on the scale.
It seems like the triglyceride to HDL ratio is really kind of what's emerging as the most useful number. Yeah.
They've been saying that for quite some time now. So
I think entire countries look at cholesterol that way. That's like the standard in Sweden or something now.
They're changing it, which is good.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
It's not just a total LDL number and you're going to die.
Well,
here's a statin.
Let's be honest. LDL was pretty much created by the pharmaceutical company, as far as the idea of it, just so they could sell statins.
Mm-hmm.
So really and honestly.
$30 billion a year, probably more than that now.
Yeah.
So from what I've read and watched a bunch of documentaries on that, it seems like they were trying to do it with HDL. But the problem is they could never raise HDL on people without them having like some significant negative effects. But they realized they could lower LDL without any significant effects. They had effects. They are aware of the effects, but it's not killing people. So they were like, "Hey, we can make money off of that." All of a sudden, the LDL numbers started going lower and lower and lower. Recommendation for the LDL went much lower, down to what? I think they recommend like 100 now, which is ridiculous.
It's ridiculous. Yeah. I remember when they recommended 200 or below.
200, that's right. 200.
And it just keeps dropping.
Dumb. I mean, 100, man. Talk about all carbs mortality issue.
Well, and now they have those that PKS9 inhibitors.
Yeah.
You can drop your cholesterol down to 20.
Whoa, no.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
That's horrible.
I heard it described as like a medication looking for a problem. like they've come up with this inhibitor, and it's like, what are we going to treat with this? You know, right. Like, we got this super drug, you know, what are we going to do with it? So
they got this big hammer, they want to find a nail for it.
I'm pretty sure that's what it's called, PKS9.
It is. When you said that name, it clicked in my head that I'd heard of that before.
Yeah. It's kind of scary. It's like, I think it just turns a switch off, which you figure the more drugs they come up with, they can just flip a switch like that. Because your liver is supposed to make like 200 milligrams of cholesterol per day, you know, roughly.
So it doesn't even need it from food. It just makes it. So
yeah, well, just like glucose.
It helps with food, but yeah.
Right?
Yeah, just like glucose. Naturally made. Yeah, naturally made. That's right.
And now they're going to try to block that.
Well, they've been doing it with insulin.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
If you really want to consider that. So.
Yeah, well, there's got to be a better way.
Yeah.
Carnivore. How about that way?
Diet.
That's right.
Stay away from processed food.
Fucking meat. Yeah.
Yeah.
Franken food.
Yeah. So what you're saying is you're not big on the pea isolate, the pea protein isolates there, Mark?
No. Or the soybean isolated proteins. Yeah. No. That pea protein, though, just being around, I've noticed it's starting to come on a little bit, a little more than, nobody'd look at that crap back in the old days.
Well,
milk and egg.
I think this is the opportunity that's presenting itself, is a lot of the big meat companies, the big, the big slaughterhouses that ship to the supermarkets are looking at getting out of livestock products and getting into fake meats because they're going to be more profitable. So I think that's going to create more of an opportunity for ranchers who are going to sell direct. You could sell a higher quality, say grass finished a beef or maybe grain finished, whatever, but you can be able to sell that directly because you're not going to have the competition and the super low prices from the giant meat companies in the future.
Yeah. It's going to be interesting. I don't think this, and what is it? Beyond Beef.
Impossible Burger.
The other one.
Impossible Burger. Yeah.
The only thing is most, and not everybody, but there's a lot of people, they just don't care what they eat, especially the younger people. They just don't care. So if you're eating pizza on a daily basis, you don't really care what you're eating.
Or really, it's more ignorance than caring. I just don't think they know, and there's that addictive effect to that food too. So you compound that. I mean, that's a bad combination.
Yeah, that when you start having problems and you start looking into,
that's when you start caring. Yeah.
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 Yeah. A lot of us came to carnivore. Looks like he froze up a little there. Is he frozen to you?
Yeah, he's frozen. Yeah, totally frozen.
Bummer. But yeah, it looks like a lot of us came to this because we were sick. Well, hopefully, yeah. We didn't lose Mark. He's not coming back.
I think we did.
I think we might have lost Mark, but we had a great discussion. So this was a lot of fun. So did you have any, oh, there he's back.
There you go.
You're back. Hey, Mark.
Yeah. Mark, oh. We lost you there.
Yeah, what I was saying, way back in the 90s, there was a guy, he wasn't keto, he wasn't any of that, but he ran a bodybuilding magazine called Muscle Media 2000. Huh. And he says, I think that the average lifespan of the American people will drop in the next 40 years because of the way they're eating. And he was right.
He called it. Yeah, he called it. That's an awesome call.
Yeah.
It's too bad.
It's too bad. But here we are. A lot of us are, you know, there's this huge resurgence, you know, the whole low-carb movement, keto, yeah, and carnivore is growing.
Clearly. Like I said, I dropped out of it I quit following it, not the diet, but social media for 5 years. I come back in and it's blown. It's a lot bigger than it was.
Yeah.
It's huge. And it's going to get only bigger. I mean, yeah, people like me and Tom, we're going to make it as big as possible. So
Raymond,
I know you're not on social media, but we're trying to make it big.
Raymond made it into Men's Health Magazine.
Oh, very good.
And he was in the paper in Atlanta, right?
Yeah, it was. Yeah. And both of them mentioned carnivore, so that's the important part. Yeah.
The more exposure, the better.
And, you know, Nevada Gray, she's the one who had the Cotta Aquinas like you. She was in Women's Health magazine.
That's right. She was.
She's a carnivore advocate, too. So
very good.
Yeah.
The more people you can get to go to advertise it. Like, I didn't understand it's, I guess, the significance of Joe Rogan for a long time.
Right.
But, you know, Joe, he's extremely popular, very popular.
Yeah.
And he tries a carnivore diet, which gets it out there to that many more people.
Millions.
So even though he's not an expert himself, he's trying it. I had somebody way back, you know, he interviewed Dominic D'Agostino, which is big on keto, years ago. And this kid comes to, well, he wasn't a kid, he was about 40 years old, so it's only a few years ago. He says, man, I'm going to do this keto thing. Joe Rogan says it's good for me, blah, blah. And I said, you know, Joe, that's good. Joe Rogan's proven it, but he's not the scientist who's doing, he's not down in the trenches. He learned about this from a guy named Dominic D'Agostino. He didn't care about the scientists, the science behind it. Joe Rogan did it. He's going to do it.
Right.
Okay. go for it because it worked for you. And it did. It worked for him.
Yeah, it was very significant for me and a lot of other people when we saw Sean Baker on Rogan. You know,
that's like, good.
That for me was like, I'm 100% convinced now. Yeah. I didn't even realize that Sean has a Facebook group called World Carnivore Tribe, and I had joined that. And I want to say when I joined that, I found that it was like 5,000 people. I was like, oh my god, that 5,000 people in one Facebook group, and there was other carnivore groups as well.
And what's it now, like 20 or something crazy like that?
Oh, it's over 40 now.
Oh, is it 40 now? God.
Yeah, the last couple of years, it's grown from like 5 or 6,000 to like 40,000 people in that one group. And there's many other
groups. And there's many groups, yeah.
Good thing about that, I actually joined that. I had no idea who it was connected to. I actually joined it. And so if you ask a question on there, you're going to get 40 answers.
Yeah.
You know,
this is true.
People are going to respond to you very quickly.
Yeah.
Makes it a lot easier. Yeah. And very quickly. You're right.
Yeah.
I think it's great. I think it's great. And I hope it improves a lot of people's health. Yeah. Hopefully, nobody be kicking over from heart attacks and strokes and stuff.
Yeah.
And that's the thing. You know, I know it's a hard message for a lot of people to accept carnivore diet, but to hear this answer that seems to cure so many things, just to hear it. And they're thinking to themselves, hey, when they're that bad off, they may actually go that route. And that's all it takes. That's it. Because let me tell you, when I reached 45, I had so many problems that I was like thinking, if it keeps progressively getting worse, I don't know how I'm going to last another 5 years because of the pain. Not just living. I didn't kind of want to live through that. You know, it was just that bad.
Yeah.
Your joints, your joint pain. And
no, my IBD was the worst. Yeah. So I think it was diverticulitis. I never actually got checked. But I was having pain scales where, you know, the best pain scale was like a 12 where I'd pass out. But when it got to 11, right before I could pass out and I couldn't pass out, I tried to knock myself out. If I had a gun, I would shoot myself. That's the kind of pain scale I had.
Well, so, I'm sure I'm happy you found it.
No kidding. So, I mean, it actually started around 43. Oh, and I was, I had bloody stool every quarter.
Yeah.
And, I was like thinking to myself, and colds every month. I mean, colds just constant sinus issues, snoring. I had so many problems. So by the time I was 45, I literally thought, I was like, man, I guess this is what being old feels like. This is, and it's just going to keep getting worse. And I'm like, okay, Vika, it's worse. How am I going to live with this? You know? So when I found out about carnivore, I mean, it's like you took that body, put it in somebody else's 20-year-old, very healthy body. I've never in my life felt that good or being able to perform how I perform.
What? I mean, totally 360, it sounded like. Went back towards health.
I was I was actually one of the guys that was crawling to the grave. That's how bad it was. I wanted to die at certain points, you know, and to turn that around to think, you know, I couldn't run half a mile to save my life. And I'm doing 10 miler in 10 minute per mile seconds now. I'm doing, you know, like this morning I did Orange Theory and then I went to Jiu-Jitsu. I did the Orange Theory, which is a hit like CrossFit for an hour. And then I went straight into Jiu-Jitsu. We did that for about an hour and a half, you know, and that was next to nothing. Yesterday I did that and I added karate, you know, in that. And this doesn't feel like anything. It doesn't wear me out at all. So it's like I got some kind of superhuman power from it. You know, it's unbelievable.
Did you notice you had more endurance, Mark, when you switched the
car? Yeah, good question. Did you?
Yeah, it is.
No, Mark, did you
notice? Live life again.
Yeah. But did you notice anything like that with endurance and strength yourself, Mark?
Yeah, endurance and strength went up, actually, especially endurance. Just to be able to sustain a working level for longer periods of time.
Yes.
Even if it was compared to like shoveling snow or working out in the yard all day or something like that, you're able to sustain that for the whole day without really becoming exhausted.
And you can bounce back so quick. It's like you just take a little bit of break and you're ready to go on for more.
Right, yeah, you come back in, you know, drink water or whatever, you're ready to go back out.
Yep. It's like nothing touched you. It's crazy. Yeah, your
recovery is great.
Yeah.
Recovery is outstanding.
So it's incredible. So,
yeah, it is.
Well, this has been a great interview. I don't know how long we've been talking, but a long time.
Almost an hour and a half.
I quite enjoyed it.
I did too. It's wonderful. But,
like I said, I've only been on a couple of MeetRx's ones, and I usually just chime in and watch what's going on.
Yeah.
And I was pretty comfortable with the format of this.
It was great having you. Hopefully we can do this again. Well, I'm sure we won't run out of things to talk about. So.
No, we could probably talk for a long time.
Yeah, I know that we've got another guy who's been making this long list of all the little things that have improved. You know, it's probably, we could all probably make a list of like a page or two long of all the things that have gotten better with our health, you know. So we'll have to do that sometime. We'll show up with a list and go through the list.
That'd be good, Mark. I am curious about your list, actually. Yeah, I mean, you know, if you actually had to sit down and actually think about all the stuff that you had wrong before.
That'd be
a lot. Yeah, I know.
I never had it as bad as what you're saying, but I'm starting thinking about IBS, but yours was, mine was never that extreme. But yeah, I mean, it was pretty bad. And I went this way, I don't have it no more. I haven't had it for 12, you know, I don't like bouts of diarrhea.
Yeah.
Not there. I'm pretty healthy. And I think actually everyone after so long, you know, everybody might need different stages of healing their gut or their immune system, but I think eventually everyone definitely benefit extremely well.
No doubt.
Power of the ruminants.
Yes.
That's right. Yeah.
Well, I think we'll wrap this one up here. I want to thank everybody for watching. I hope you guys enjoyed this conversation as much as we did, because we get a lot of pleasure out of this. We hope this helps somebody out there, inspires people out there. Maybe you can send a link to this video to somebody who might enjoy it or benefit from it. And if you subscribe to the channel, that's always appreciated. Leave us a comment or give us a thumbs up. And hopefully we'll have more of these videos out soon. So thanks again, everybody. Appreciate you being here. Everybody feel better.